because he is no having, that is incapable. If a person is totally incapable, not having the capable power to harm others, his ahimsa is useless. I am not harming anybody because I am not capable of harming others. And this type of ahimsa is not worthy at all. So ahimsa is not worthy if a person is not harming others because of his incapability, because of not having any reason, because of not having opportunity. So the Shastra say, if you have a reason to harm others, somebody is wounding you. If somebody is not wounding you, why you are doing ahimsa or why you are practicing himsa? If somebody is not connected with you, what is the thing that urges you to go for that himsa or ahimsa? So that should be a reason to harm a person. That you should control yourself from harming the person. Number one, you should have the capability to harm the person. That you should control that you won't do that harm. Third thing, you must be having an opportunity to harm. So most of the people are now practicing ahimsa because they don't have the capability, they don't have proper reason, and they have not been given the opportunities. This type of ahimsa is not glorious. So the Shastra says that you should have an opportunity, you should also have a reason and also a capability. That you have to shower mercy and see that the person is made corrigible. This is not as real. And second thing, there are a lot of ethical issues in ahimsa. Food cycle. Eating lot of non-vegetarian things is very common in herbivorous and carnivorous animals. The food cycle that deals with violence. But that is a biological violence. Whatever we are doing is psychological violence. Biological violence is natural. Without that it cannot survive. But our violence is optional and it is psychological error. So we cannot compare this thing to that. So food cycle. Second thing is biocide. We are killing lot of living beings in various contexts. Number one, I want to say hunting. You are killing lot of wild animals. Number two, deforestation. You are cutting lot of trees. And third thing, insecticides. You are killing mosquitoes and other various other insects. Where to administer ahimsa there. And fourth thing is very simple. Legal execution where people are executed in the terms of punishment by justice. That is a coherent order of life. The coherent order of life is binded by uniformity of mutual affinity, relativity and productivity. And killing these type of insects like mosquitoes and disease causing insects, they don't come under the coherent cycle of uniformity. That's why killing is not a problem. And then legal execution for justice is also social amputation, wherein by unwanted and harmful portions are by surgery removed in our bodies. Social amputations in the case of incorrigible creatures for assuring peace and happiness for the uncountable myriads of innocent and poor people, we have to execute that. So ahimsa is not only refrainment from himsa or violence, it is also proper administration of violence wherever it is required within the limited dosage for a limited number of people, wherein by unless administered it will harm the mass society or mass core. So ahimsa is not only apart from non-violence, it is also having a violent dimension where it is having a rational violence, where it is having a systematized violence, where it is having an interpretable violence. It is what say. And the third point of the Vedas as per we have had from our scriptures is very interesting. Ahimsa, a person does not harm any other person, is simply an important person. He should have some other additional qualities. First is ahimsa, second is satya. He must be having truth. If a person is not harming anybody, not doing anything, he is nowhere different from a car sleeping inside a graveyard or a milestone. He should have a laudable quality also. So number one is he must have non-violence. Non-violence should be based on truth, and truth must be based on penance. That is known as tapasya. And these three qualities, a person who is deep-rooted in the qualities of truth and humanitarianism, he should be having non-violence, as well as the person should have a deep mental thinking and mental sturdity, a divine power, the power of God, the power of purity he should possess. A person not having power of purity or truth, merely having non-violence, he is not adorable, he is not communicable, he is not laudable or profitable to the society. So it should be coupled with the qualities of truth as well as coupled of the greatest spiritual or moral courage. Without that moral courage, that thing is useless. So this person practicing non-violence with truth and spiritual courage will have a divine intelligence and effulgence, which we call in Sanskrit as tejas. Such a person as having divine resplendence, such a person by seeing the people he can attract, seeing their enemies he can reduce them into ashes. Such a capability is known as tejas. So the Shastras are our ancestors. They have not given an impotent, fit for nothing, irresponsible ahimsa and non-violence. Non-violence embedded with power, power of mass attraction, mass protest, power to command and demand the society, power to summon the ruling power and make them to prostrate before their feet and see that the truth is heard and justice is given audience. This type of greatest power has been given in our Shastras. And this type of self-refinement, that is very great, and that comes only by proper teaching, proper training and proper inheritance. Because whenever you see somebody crying, the mind will react in two methodologies. There are two manifestations of mind. If somebody cries, reciprocation, second thing is exasperation. If somebody is already crying, as a human being, as a part of this universe, you have to also cry and do the work. If you don't cry, then you are not a human being, part of the life at all. Such as if you have any part in your body which is subjected to bleeding, immediately you will feel the pain and cry. Likewise, in a social urbanism, wherever you see people suffering, you have to reciprocate. Reciprocation is a good opportunity. The other thing is exasperate. If somebody cries, if you cry, that is reciprocation. If somebody is already crying, you make them cry more, that is exasperation. That is a natural psychological blend in this society which should be treated. That should be treated only by exposure. People like students or police people or any person who is going to rule power, have money, they should be first given social service projects. They have to see and feel. Amidst the people, they have to see and feel what is hunger, what is poverty, what is insufficiency, what is malnutrition, what is disease and death, what is excruciating pain, what is separation and loneliness. They should be subjected to these grounds empathetically, and they should be taught the rule how to experience this thing so that they will have that reflection whenever see somebody suffering like that. So they should be given this type of opportunity, without which there is no use for that. So this type of opportunity, without which there is no use for that. So this type of non-violence which we have to practice is, first they have to have the proper system of learning, education, exposure and experience in empathy. They say in Shastras, they have to experience the fear, they have to experience the insecurity. Exposure, not only going to theatres, not only going to big places and malls and big eco centres, they have to also visit some areas where people are suffering, where people are struggling and crying. They have to be exposed at least. And education should lead them to know about all of these things. So education, exposure and experience should be given to all of these people in non-violence. And how to give all of these things? There are innumerable ways for mind taming. One is art and architecture. Persons who are exposed with art forms, they will be made smooth and soft. So there are five forms told in our scriptures. One is art and architecture. Second is social service program. Third thing is religious refinement. Fourth thing is family inheritance. And fifth thing is education and maturity. So you can teach non-violence by education and maturity in schools, number one. And number two, directly subjecting them to social service projects. Each and every student after 10th standard, 2 months they have to suffer in a slum. Then only they can realize what is pain and what is violence and non-violence. So family inheritance, the family people, they should be a good role model to the children. So family inheritance, private subjection to social service projects, art and architecture, all of these various five major religious refinement like baptism, like various samskaras, they are meant for softening the person's mind. It creates emotional ability. For example, if you go for puja, they are hard in nature. Whereas painting, dance, music, architecture and other art forms, they are very casual, they are very attractive, they are very soothing. They are very comfortable to you, so that any person doing a good painting about the position of the people with the thought, he should mix the paint with the pain of the people. He should mix the colors with the glamour and manner of the society. He should mix each and every concept of the world with the colors of the gray, and he has to present that model. Anybody moving with the society and its pain, certainly he will not harm anybody. He will see that nobody harms any other person. So this type of deep-rooted intravenous injection of the philosophy or the policy of non-violence can be practiced only by music, dance and painting. So these things, they attract, they create emotional ability. What is emotional ability? A mother crying for her patient's son is known as emotion. If the son is a patient and mother cries, that is mere emotion. If the doctor is also having the same emotion, but that is emotional ability. He converts his emotion. What is the requirement for the mother that the son must be cured? That is the same requirement for the doctor also, but he is not embracing the mother or the father and crying along with them. He comforts and consoles them and goes for ability by his surgical and pathological skills. That is known as emotional ability. Wherever we have emotions, don't be broken. Convert them, solidify them into proper political force or impact force, whereby we can create a lot of wonders in society. And somebody asked me, can